Live text access training for real-time intralingual subtitlers. Unit 1, Understanding Accessibility, Element 1, Basic Concepts. This video lecture raises awareness and calls real-time subtitlers to action by digging into the question about how subtitles can contribute to create accessible working settings that are universally useful. My name is Sofia Bernabé from the Internationale Hochschule in München in Germany. I have prepared this video lecture in collaboration with the European Federation of Hard of Hearing, in short, EFHO. On completion of this training sequence, you will be able to identify features to design accessible settings that take into consideration universal design. The agenda. We start recalling the definition of universal design. Then we discuss how real-time subtitlers can contribute as co-creators. Universal design, real-time subtitling settings. The idea of universally useful or one size fits all means that design should be usable for all. In 1998, Ronald Mays explained that universal design is the goal, but this goal cannot be achieved completely because each of us has different needs. This is when personalization comes into play. Personalization is understood as minimum adaptations that must be made in an environment to enable each of us to achieve usability. These adaptations should be both possible and simple to make, especially in environments that have been designed following the principles of universal design. An example that illustrates this idea would be the design of multimodal learning materials that do not depend on a single sense like sight, movement, hearing, or touch. If we take this idea to real-time settings such as television, face-to-face, or remote, we see that each setting should offer alternatives for personalization. The extent to which this is possible usually depends on both technology and the ability of a subtitler to adjust his or her output to the needs of the audience. Subtitles already promote equity because they provide a written equivalent to audio content. To provide the best service possible, real-time subtitlers can undertake several actions before the meeting. Some examples are to request information to prepare for the job. This can be the agenda, the list of participants, or other materials. It is also important to clarify where you will sit at the location and if there is enough space for your whole equipment. If it is online, you can ask whether only the client will be watching the subtitles on a separate screen or if the subtitles will be available for all participants. Sometimes a confidentiality agreement will be necessary, for instance, for medical consultations. Confidentiality is also an aspect that concerns transcripts. While in some countries and contexts providing the transcript is not a problem, in others this is not allowed. Take care of yourself. Talk to the client and the organizer and agree on the breaks. Also discuss the possibility of having to intervene, for instance, when there is too much background noise that it is hindering your work. Lastly, you could ask the organizer to introduce you and your role at the beginning of the meeting, which will raise awareness among participants. Flexibility in use means to provide subtitles in a way that can be used according to the preferences of your client or the audience during or after the real-time situation. Flexibility in TV settings is more limited than in face-to-face or remote ones. Indeed, it is not long ago that subtitles were only showed through the teletext. Now, with the smart TVs, the possibilities are increasing and, for example, closed captions are quite common. In face-to-face and remote settings, personalization is easier to implement. Technical possibilities are greater, and subtitlers often have more control over how to show the subtitles. New technologies such as text on top enable subtitlers to position and reposition subtitles ad hoc, and for instance, place them either at the bottom or at the top of PowerPoint slides, or even show subtitles in individual tablets or laptops close to users. Another personalization example is the software Text on Tap, which allows users to choose their own settings. At events, technical staff sometimes implement elegant solutions such as combining all input streams, slides, speaker input, subtitles, and sign language interpretation, on one big screen. Another example of flexible use is the Norwegian Opera House in Oslo. Here, subtitles are on a screen at the back of the seat in front of you, and it is the choice of the individual to turn them on and off and to choose the language you want to use. Lastly, flexibility in use can also mean using the subtitles afterwards. One example are Hansards, which are reports of what has been said in Parliament and can be accessed online after the debates. Making transcripts available can be tricky. In educational settings, transcripts are often provided to students because they cannot read the subtitles and take notes at the classroom at the same time. Conversely, transcripts are not provided after conferences. This grounds on the idea that the spoken word cannot be reheard after the conference, and so should real-time subtitles not be reread afterwards either. How to use and operate subtitles should be simple and intuitive. Operating subtitles on TV or on a tablet may seem quite straightforward. However, this task may be more difficult in settings such as theater or at the movies. And it becomes even more interesting if we consider that there might be children in the audience. Perceptible information is principle number 4. Perceiving subtitles should be as easy as possible, or in other words, require the less effort possible. Making subtitles perceptible to users requires considering two main aspects, legibility and synchrony. Legibility deals with features that affect the decoding of information during the first interaction between a reader and a text. In written texts, perception is influenced by parameters that range from typographical to paratextual. Some examples are font size, font type, contrast, and a steady position on screen. The way the words appears on screen also plays a role. Users often prefer whole words, phrases, or sentences over subtitles that show letter by letter. Here, the context plays a role again. While in TV, personalization of these settings is more limited, in face-to-face and remote contexts, subtitlers can react to the preferences of their audiences and, for instance, change the font type, the size, or even the color. For example, from white on a black background to yellow on a black background. Synchrony is also a feature that supports perception. As you probably remember from other lectures, persons with hearing loss also resort to lip reading during communication. In this sense, subtitles should be in synchrony with the speech as much as possible. In online meetings, this implies that the camera shift must be quick. As my colleague Aida Regel-Poulsen says, when synchrony fails, real-time subtitling becomes wrong-time subtitling. Principle number 5 is tolerance of error. We all make mistakes. The question here is what type of errors can subtitlers predict and already plan how to react in order to be quickly solved in real-time settings. With regards to spelling mistakes, Mistakes must be corrected in real time. Users of subtitles often prefer corrections over deleting the whole subtitle and retyping it again. As for errors that concern your technical equipment, you should always plan B. Reaching the venue timely and testing the equipment before the job seems to be a good strategy. Lastly, carrying a spare keyboard, cable, adapter, or microphone can sometimes become very handy. Low physical effort is the sixth principle. However, in real-time subtitling, low cognitive effort seems more suitable. As discussed in previous lectures, persons with hearing loss always make an extra effort to understand. Subtitlers can facilitate this process by improving readability of subtitles. These improvements can be in terms of linguistic correctness, proper style, and clarity. In some cases, this will mean choosing between verbatim or word-to-word subtitles and subtitles that are edited to avoid repetitions, to reorder the message, or to add contextual information. Finally, on face-to-face and remote settings, subtitlers can also more easily adapt to the output to the needs of the audience. For instance, when working with audiences with a low command of a language, subtitlers can try to type slower and leave out difficult words while maintaining the message of the speaker. In these cases, we could also talk about universally designed content because more people will be able to follow a speech or a meeting. Of course, this is only possible for certain topics and when the information density is not too high. Lastly, principle 7, size and space for approach and use. As in the previous one, we propose a slight change to size and space for reading and use. Principle 7 is grounded on the assumption that we, as humans, have different shapes and sizes. Similarly, we could say that our reading abilities and knowledge are different. This means that the subtitling speed should be based on average reading speed rates. Of course, the subtitler needs to adjust to the speed of the speaker. In the case that a speaker speaks very fast, subtitlers only have two options here, either to type or to re-speak faster, or to kindly ask the speaker to slow down a bit. To recap, we can say that universally designed settings allow for personalization, which is a key factor in the current understanding of accessibility as a whole. We have also seen that real-time subtitlers are co-creators of such settings and can influence them to make them universally more accessible. However, we have also seen that some settings are less adaptable than others. Lastly, all the possibilities and differences that we see between countries point out that there might be a need for more harmonization in the field, especially now that several online tools have emerged during the pandemic. I hope that I could provide you with food for thought for your future job as a real-time intralingual subtitler. As for now, I say goodbye and many thanks. Exercises. The exercises for this video lecture are in the trainer's guide for Unit 1 and in the PowerPoint presentation.
LTA, Live Text Access. Universitat Autonoma de Barcelona. SDI, Internationale Hochschule. Scuola Superiore per Mediatori Linguistici, ZDF Digital, European Federation of Hard of Hearing People, FHO, Velotype, SubtiAccess, European Certification and Qualification Association, ECQA. co-funded by the Erasmus Plus program of the European Union. Erasmus Plus project 2018-1-DE01-KA203-004218. The information and views set on this presentation are those of the authors and do not necessarily reflect the official opinion of the European Union, neither the European Union institutions and bodies, nor any person acting on their behalf may be held responsible for the use which may be made of the information contained here.